tonight, Superfish is still super fishy. There's a net neutrality countdown and Christina Warren's post-Oscar recap, now with more racially diverse emoji. Tech News Tonight is next.
This is Twit.
This is Tech News Tonight, episode 280 for Monday, February 23rd, 2015. This episode of Tech News Tonight is brought to you by Personal Capital. With Personal Capital, you can grow and protect your wealth. Best of all, it's free. And for a limited time, Twit viewers can qualify for up to $10,000 on any new account. To sign up, go to personalcapital.com/TN2. I'm Megan Maroney. Let's get right to today's top story. Lenovo's nasty brand of pre-installed malware is still in the news today. Lenovo has already been hit with two class action lawsuits after the company shipped laptops bundled with the spying software Superfish. Joining us to talk about these stories and others is senior tech analyst Christina Warren from Mashable. Hi, Christina.
Hey, Megan. How are you?
So I'm good. One of the lawsuits is from a woman claiming that her system was compromised with profanity or profane images. And can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, she's claiming that that profane images showed up on her computer and that was as a result of this Lenovo Superfish stuff. Whether that's actually true or not remains to be seen. I'm a little bit skeptical on that end. But when things like this happen, as we saw last week and continuing into this week with the sort of adware stuff, lots of people are going to be upset and lots of lawsuits are going to be filed. I mean, I think we're just at the very beginning stages of the angry customers over Superfish.
I know. It is a horrible story. My nephew spent all of his money that he'd saved up on a Lenovo laptop. He was so upset. And it just broke my heart. But I'm not even sure if it's one of the laptops that is actually installed with Superfish. It's just the story's just sort of out there. And I think Lenovo is really not going to do so well after this.
No, I mean, you're absolutely right. I mean, that's the thing, is that they did release a list of the laptops that are affected, but it's a ton of laptops and they didn't release the number. They just released the models that are impacted. And then, you know, the federal government is saying, well, actually, we think there might have been even more laptops going back to 2010. And, you know, it becomes a big mess. And I think for anybody who I purchased Lenovo laptops for my father and for my sister. And I, you know, like your nephew, I think anybody who's purchased one of these devices, whether it's impacted or not, just having the name Lenovo on it and seeing things in the news, people are understandably getting freaked out, and Lenovo hasn't had a really great response as this is happening, and only been, you know, the last couple of days that they've really had tools that will adequately remove this stuff from their systems.
Right. So the other news is that other companies are sending out software that's similar to Superfish, also leaving people open to man-in-the-middle attacks. And some of this is security software. What do we know about this so far?
Yeah, so then that's what's actually really interesting about this, is that there's, you know, basically this framework that Superfish was using is called Komodo, and it's used by a lot of different apps, and including some security software, including some parenting, you know, some nanny, you know, cyber nanny software. And so, you know, Facebook, one of their employees wrote a really interesting post kind of talking about all the different you know, pieces of software that are impacted by this, but it's just kind of showing that this framework, which is basically breaking SSL on Windows, is in a lot of pieces of software that we might not have ever thought about. And it's really, I think, opening up more questions than we'd previously thought about, because it's not just about Superfish. It's not just about Lenovo. It's about how many programs come with this sort of thing bundled with them, how many laptops from other manufacturers might have this. We just really don't know the answers. And I think we're just still at the beginning stages of trying to figure out how deep this really goes.
So is anyone recommending at this point that we not enter credit card information, or, you know, is that really panicking? I mean, how safe is SSL? How safe is the lock icon?
Yeah, I mean, at this point, you know, Rob Graham from Arata Security was able to actually, I think, get to someone's computer with a very specific method using some of the Superfish stuff by exploiting their root certificate. But at this point, you know, it hasn't been, quote unquote, weaponized in the sense that people are not actively exploiting this. So at this point, it hasn't broken out into being like a full blown thing that everybody, you know, regardless of who makes your computer, should be worried about. But if you do have a Lenovo computer, especially if it's one you bought within the last, you know, 4 to 5 months, it's it's not a bad idea to run the remover tool or to use Windows Defender to see if that's there and to go ahead and clean it up. But the good news is we haven't seen anybody actually exploiting this, at least to our knowledge, yet. So that's the good news. The problem, of course, is that if this stuff has kind of been lurking there and if it's easy for someone to kind of create malware that might be installed in other ways and people could get it installed and they are on a machine that could be vulnerable, obviously bad things could happen. So, you know, I think that's one of the reasons why there have been so many articles. It's been good that it's kind of made international news so that people who have purchased computers in the last few months can go ahead and do their due diligence and run updates to get this stuff off their machines.
So that's what they're recommending now, just to run Windows Update, make sure they have the latest security updates. They're not saying, like, there's no talk of a recall or anything like that, right?
No talk of a recall. You know, I mean, I think that, you know, obviously, McAfee and Microsoft have both issued malware definition updates, you know, against this stuff. So if you're using Windows Defender, which is built into Windows 8 and it's available for download for Windows 7, you know, you can run that. And if it finds the stuff on it, it'll remove it. McAfee's got something similar. There are a number of sites that will run a check for Superfish for you and for this other stuff. And Lenovo's offering a removal tool. So, I mean, that's basically what we're recommending people do right now until we see any signs that it's gone further or that it's actually been weaponized. That's the best advice I can give people. You know, I would not go into panic mode, but if you've got a Lenovo computer and you bought it between, you know, September and last week, it's probably not a bad idea to run some of these checks just to make sure that you're up to date and that nothing potentially bad is lurking on your machine.
All right. Let's move on to net neutrality. The vote is this Thursday. Things are heating up. Republicans want to see the proposed rule in advance of Thursday's vote. And they're also asking FCC Chairman Tom Wheeler to release the proposal to the public and postpone the Thursday vote to allow for 30 days of public comment. What do you think is going to happen next?
Yeah, I mean, you know, honestly, I would be surprised if the vote, I guess, takes place. I think that the call for public comment probably is worth noting. There's been so much public discussion around this. I mean, that's frankly why Tom Wheeler changed his proposal from where it was a year ago to what it is now. So I would not be surprised if the vote is delayed, but it's really coming kind of down to the wire. I mean, it's interesting to kind of see the responses from the various, groups, internet groups, responses to Wheeler's proposal, and I guess we'll see.
Yeah, I mean, these Republicans are saying that he's not being transparent enough, but he laid it out pretty clear what he was going to do. So, I mean, what's wrong with that 4-page fact sheet that he produced?
No, I think that honestly they're wanting to kind of split hairs over things because, frankly, I think he's been a lot more transparent now than he has been leading up to this process. You know, frankly, I think that what he was saying a year ago, I would agree, was not really transparent. But what's happened now has been a lot more open, and his rationale for why he's proposing Title II has been a lot more open. I think that there are a lot of considerations and obviously a lot of debate that will go into effect whether that happens or not. But I think I disagree with the notion that he hasn't been transparent in this case, because if anything, I think I would say that the public outpour of support and just the fact the public has been so adamant about wanting that neutrality to be a reality has forced the FCC to be a lot more open about this process than they probably would have been if that hadn't happened.
Right. Well, now Twitter came out today in a blog post saying they were in support of net neutrality, but Google came out today saying that they're worried that the new net neutrality rules could end up allowing ISPs to charge web services for sending traffic. Now, what's going on here?
So basically, you know, what Google's kind of arguing, and it's something similar that other groups have kind of argued as well, which potentially what they're saying is if this happens, because both the commercial agreements and the consumer agreements would both be Title II, then these interconnect fees, which is what happens, for instance, when you kind of connect, you know, one network to another. So when Netflix is able to connect to an ISP like, say, Comcast or Verizon or Optimum or somebody else, and they're able to have fast traffic switches, there are sometimes what are called interconnect fees. And that became a big topic last year because obviously Comcast and Time Warner Cable both signed interconnect agreements with Netflix. Netflix agreed to pay them to carry their traffic. And the question becomes, if both of these things are considered under Title II, then this agreement where a web service might have to pay for traffic from an interconnect fee, whether it really exists or not, Google's concerned about the language that would allow that to happen, especially, they say, in foreign countries. So they're looking at this abroad saying, oh, hey, you know, services abroad might, and ISPs abroad might use this as an opportunity to say, hey, you know, we're carrying all the backhaul for you, even if they're really not, and we're going to force you to pay a fee to connect our two networks together. They're concerned that the language is not clear enough in the Title II distinction by being Title II that it would prevent that from happening. So it does open up some interesting questions. And the FCC's response to that in the past has basically been to say, you know, we have this language here just in case this sort of thing, just to ensure net neutrality happens, but we're hoping that it wouldn't come to that. But it does become an open question, which is if there's any sort of loophole at all for companies and ISPs, especially to charge extra, they probably will. So it does open up some interesting questions about the fact that just because something's Title II, just because it's common carrier, doesn't necessarily mean that all of the fears people have over net neutrality would immediately be dissipated, because this is still a bureaucratic mess at the end of the day.
Right. Well, let's hope they have the vote on Thursday so we can start talking about more important topics like racially diverse emojis and the Oscars. Let's start with the racially diverse emojis. I know you have an opinion on that.
It's kind of cool. So, I mean, basically, you know, the Unicode group released something last July, basically saying, yeah, you know, we need our emojis to be more diverse. And so Apple, in the latest beta for OS 10 Yosemite, actually has emoji pickers for different ethnicities. So what's weird, though, is that coloring is yellow, you know, it's very Simpsons-esque. So some people are having problems with that. They're saying, wait a minute, are you saying that the Asian people are yellow? But it is finally showing different skin variants rather than just having the Caucasian emoji. They're different shades going from yellow all the way to dark brown. So that's good. I mean, and different hair color things too. So, I mean, you know, obviously this is still beta on Apple's part, and this is still not completely ratified in the Unicode spec, but it's a great sign that we are going to be getting emojis that are more diverse. And what's nice about this is, at least in OS 10, and I assume this will be the case in iOS as well, is it's very easy to choose what color you want to use for your message. So it can be customized for different parts of the world. What's also nice is that if you're using this now with someone who is not running the latest version of OS 10, you're not going to see a white square if you send someone one of those messages. They will still be defaulted to whatever the basic, at this point, you know, unfortunately, Caucasian emoji looks like. So messages won't be messed up. But in the future, you know, people can send messages to one another that actually represent what they look like rather than what the icon designers think they look like.
Right. So then the default is Caucasian, which is unfortunate. Now, do you have to press the Caucasian emoji to see the rest of them, or you set it and you always
I think you can set it. There's a little drop down menu. Actually, right now the default is yellow. I guess the Asian color. So I'm not really sure what's going on with that. And I assume that maybe it could be based on your country. That would probably be a smart thing to do. Or maybe make it opt in. I'm not really sure how they're going to handle that. Again, this is still in beta. You know, this is just for the developer preview of OS 10. But we do at least see for the first time emojis with different coloring. So.
Right.
Progress.
And all the smiley faces and the cats are also yellow. So I don't know what that says about anything.
Exactly. But Santa Claus can now be, you know, it can now be multi-ethnic, which is important.
Right. So let's move on to even more tough hitting topic, the Oscars. I know you have a background in film, so we had to have your feedback on this. I personally did not watch them. I'm sorry to say that. I hope that's not upsetting to you.
Well, you're not alone. You're not alone. I mean, actually, the ratings were the lowest they've been in 6 years. You know, the ratings were down significantly from last year. And actually, social media chatter was down, too. So you're not alone. I did watch the Oscars, and I live tweeted them, as I always do. But not a lot of people, at least compared to the past, tuned in, which is probably representative of the films that were up this year and just kind of the year at the movies that it was. But It was a down year for the Academy.
Right. Well, see, you know, you live tweeted it, but then I was able to read all your tweets this morning, and
you caught up.
Exactly.
You learned everything.
Yeah.
So you didn't have to Stay up for 4 hours.
Yeah. So there were some interesting moments. There were some interesting memes before and after. I was really interested in the hashtag ask her more that a lot of actors were, female actors were saying, you know, ask me more than my dress. Did they talk a lot about that at the on the red carpet?
Yeah, I mean, that was something that Reese Witherspoon and some of the other actresses really started. And it was kind of a nice kind of form, way of saying, hey, you know, I'm about more than just my dress. Ask me more things. And that, I think, opened up some interesting conversations online and on Twitter especially. You know, it was kind of one of those examples of kind of, you know, hashtag activism. But I think it highlighted some important points, which is that the red carpet is about what you're wearing in your dresses. And that's important. But a lot of times with women especially, the entire conversation on the red carpet comes about what they're wearing rather than the work they're doing. Doing and what they're being nominated for, whereas for men, they oftentimes would be asked more questions about the work itself. And so that was nice to see, frankly, the Hollywood community and actresses standing up and saying, no, actually, you know what, I want to have a broader conversation about the work that I'm doing rather than just the dress that I'm wearing.
Right. So what were your favorite moments of the evening?
My favorite was actually the speech that the screenwriter for The Imitation Game gave, and there was also another kind of trending hashtag on Twitter, Stay Weird, because he, at the end of his speech, he said, you know, I'm never going to really have this opportunity again, and he shared that when he was 16 years old, he almost committed suicide, and he thought that he didn't fit in and that he was would never amount to anything and that he didn't have a place in the world. And so he was sending encouragement to other people who might be like him out there who felt like they were too weird and felt like they were too different. And he said, you know, stay weird and basically kind of saying keep on persevering because you never know what's going to happen. And that was, it was an emotional speech. It was a really kind of profound moment. And so Stay Weird was trending on Twitter, but I thought just, it was a really beautiful moment, and it was great for him to kind of take that opportunity to really speak to broader people rather than just, you know, thanking the Academy and all of his agents.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Christina. It's Christina Warren from Mashable. And what's your next story that you're working on, Christina?
Well, I'm just working on some news. There's a lot of new things coming out over the next week and a half or so for Mobile World Congress. So I'm just working on a lot of things I can't talk about right now, but I'll be able to talk about in a few days.
So, okay. So we should check back in with you in a few days to see what big story you're going to break.
Exactly.
All right. Thank you, Christina.
Thanks, Megan.
Coming up, LinkedIn settles a lawsuit and a weird bug in Gmail's autocomplete. But first, it's a new year and time to start investing smarter. Personal Capital has an easy way for you to do it right now. Plus a special offer for Twit listeners. For a limited time, when you open a new Personal Capital account, they'll give you $100 for every $100,000 that you deposit, up to $10,000. It's a win-win. You get cash in your account and personalized investment advice from their registered investment advisors. Schedule your free one-on-one investment consultation today. I don't know how long this offer will be available, so get to it now. With their award-winning financial app, you can monitor your income, spending, and the performance of your investments in real time on a single, easy-to-read screen. Find and eliminate high mutual fund and 401k fees and other hidden brokerage fees that may be costing you years off your retirement. And best of all, it is free. This is the part that I really like. Personal Capital gives you total clarity and transparency, so you really know what's going on. That way you can make better financial decisions and manage your portfolio like a pro. Now is the time to invest smarter and open a Personal Capital account. Make taking control of your financial future one of your resolutions for 2015. It's not too late. Go to Personal Capital now and set up your free account. And for a limited time, you can qualify. Personal Capital will give you $100 for every $100,000 you deposit for up to $10,000. That's personalcapital.com/TN2. And we thank Personal Capital for their support of Tech News Tonight. Now on to a few more stories we're following today. The New York Times is reporting that LinkedIn settled the class action lawsuit brought against them by 800,000 LinkedIn users who paid for the service. The lawsuit alleges that the company failed to adequately protect its users and promised a level of security for those who paid for the service that the company did not provide. You might remember that LinkedIn was hacked in 2012 and 6.5 million passwords of people who use the service and those who paid for it and those who use the free service appeared on a Russian website. And if you're an American user who paid for premium services with LinkedIn between March 15th, 2006 and June 7th, 2012, you're eligible to make a claim on the $1.25 million settlement fund. No word yet on whether I can sue for having my LinkedIn spam, having LinkedIn spam my contacts that I'm having a work anniversary at a company that I no longer work for. Apple just announced that they will spend $2 billion to build their first two data centers in Europe. The data centers will be in Ireland and Denmark. In addition to Apple, Amazon and Salesforce.com are part of a growing list of companies planning data centers in those countries due to growing data privacy concerns on the part of Europeans and the fear that the U.S. is spying on them. And speaking of spying, fresh off his Academy Award win last night, whistleblower Edward Snowden participated in the popular Ask Me Anything thread on social networking site Reddit, where he admits juicy government secrets, such as the fact that he laughed at Neil Patrick Harris's treason joke at last night's Oscars. We'll have a link to the Reddit thread in our show notes. Check it out to learn even more about the NSA and what Edward Snowden thinks is funny. And finally, be careful when you're typing email addresses today. Brad Chakos from PC World Reports and Mike Elgin from Tech News Tonight Today confirms that there's a bug in Gmail's autocomplete feature that usually brings up your most used contacts. But this morning, it didn't. So check your to line carefully. It might have brought some stranger's email address up or someone you haven't seen in decades. You might end up sending the wrong email or the wrong race of emoji to the wrong person, and that sure could be confusing. That's it for this edition of Tech News Tonight. Subscribe to the show at twit.tv/TN2. You can also write to us with hot news tips or tips about anything or suggestions or complaints or just your thought of the day to TN2 at twit.tv and watch live every weekday at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. And don't miss our morning news program, Tech News Today, every weekday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. I will be co-hosting again tomorrow morning with Mike. So wake up early and see me there. I'm Megan Maroney. Thanks for watching.
Bandwidth for Tech News Tonight is brought to you by CashFly.com.